Welcome to Road to WrestleMania, WCW nWo World Tour for Nintendo 64.
Was he holding a microphone? There's no microphone in his hand. It looks stupid right there. Where's the cord, Dad? You can't even see the cord holding up Sting, just descended down like a ghost. Okay, DDP is not fat. All right, so here we go. This game was real awesome to play. I actually played a lot of Nitro for PS1, and I was so impressed with that because of the video, the trailers, the rants that the wrestlers do, and you can actually hear the real, actual interest music and see the trailers and all that stuff. But this right here has much better gameplay. So this is the first of, I think, four THQ Wrestling games for Nintendo 64. Man, this game was pretty cool. Alright, so let me see who I can select here. There's so many characters in this game, and you can unlock several characters. I think you can unlock Diamond Dallas Page, Glacier, Wrath, and more. So who am I going to pick here? Of course, I got to pick the Nature Boy Ric Flair. Woo! Going up against Scott Steiner, you can tell this is pretty big Papa Pump. That little Dino, Scott Steiner, looks like an Asian wrestler. What the heck? They don't look like Ric Flair, looks like Dino Bravo. Look at the polygonal crowd. I tell you what though, they're gonna be a lot more active, a lot more better as far as actually cheering, as they already are right there, as opposed to the audience on Raw for the SNES. But yeah, so many great moves to do in this game. Much better gameplay than Nitro for PS1. But I still have fun with Nitro for PS1, I'm not gonna lie. Thunder 2, because of the capabilities that the PS1 was able to have at the time. You can see the rants, the trailers, and I remember Lex Luger looking funny on one of those games. His neck looked weird. He looked like freaking Earthworm Jim. All right. I mean, I'm always making fun of Lex Luger in these series of videos right here. But again, I like the total package, so I'm not going to hate on him anymore. He is in this game, but I'm not going to use him. I'm only going to use a few people, because this video is going to be long enough. And yeah, so I'm going to see if I can win the world title here with, woo, Ric Flair. Oh, come on, Ric Flair. You can't square up with Scott Steiner like that. Tiger suplex. Yep, there's his taunt. Woo! Yeah, this game came out in 1997. Yeah, this is definitely before Big Papa Pump. 1997, when WCW was in its prime. 96-97. Woo! They should have put the woo chant in there when he does that. They should put that in this game. That'd be pretty cool. Ric Flair going to the top, and it actually worked this time. Ric Flair real serious right here in this game. Oh, wait, Scott Steiner, though. Watch out for the amateur background. You know, as JR would say, Scott Steiner from Michigan University. You're playing linebacker from Michigan High School. No, I'm just kidding. Ric Flair now. Flaring up. And the background music in this wrestling game, I love that about wrestling games. It's cool. I wonder why THQ stopped doing that with SmackDown vs. Raw 2006. There's Flair special. The eye poke, begging for mercy, doing the eye poke, classic Flair. I know this is 1997, one of the earlier titles of 64. But man, speaking of four, there's the figure four. I guess you'd call this the figure 64? Fail. Okay, Scott Steiner's in the ropes. Look at that. His face is literally in the ropes. Come on now. Rope break. But what am I complaining about? Ric Flair's going for it again. Woo! Scott Steiner favoring that leg now. Going for the figure four again. Will Scott Steiner tap right here? Like I said, Scott Steiner taps. I know it's an early 64 title, and the 64 system was polygonal and all that stuff, but man, some of these characters look horrible. Will Rick Steiner get revenge on Ric Flair for beating his brother? Apologize for the little glitches right there. The lines. That does not look like Rick Steiner. Looks like an Asian Rick Steiner. I did like the Steiner brothers, though. They're probably the most technically sound wrestling tag team of all time, in my opinion. I know people say the greatest tag team of all time is the Legion of Doom, and I don't have to agree with that. My favorite, though, of all time is the Dudley Boys. Oh, Ric Flair with a shoulder block on the dog-faced gremlin. I remember a promo the Steiner Brothers did one time. They said something about, yeah, we were watching Frankenstein late at night, and we came up with a move called the Frankensteiner. Okay, cool. Ric Flair working that leg now, softening up for that patented figure four. Oh, another shoulder tackle. Going for the figure four now. Early in the match, the first minute in the match. There's a short period when I was a kid where I would actually time the matches with a stopwatch when I watched wrestling. And I remember Sting beat some jobber probably like 2 or 3 minutes. But I got bored of that quickly. I didn't want to time all the matches. I guess I wanted to be a top wrestling timekeeper when I grew up. When I was a kid, though, I did want to be a wrestler. But then that's back when I thought it was actually real. In some cases, it is real because people really do get hurt. But I thought it was like real. Like, no, not scripted, not choreographed. And I heard of wrestlers getting injured. And I changed my mind. But it turns out wrestlers really do get injured, even though it is scripted. Man, you might think, well, duh, Ronnie, we know that. Well, there's some people watching this that are not familiar with wrestling or like to knock wrestling, saying it's all fake, no one ever gets hurt. I guarantee you, people that say that will not last probably one day in a wrestling training camp. Especially with Bill DeMott. Anyway, oh, what a suplex. Cool track right here. Oh, rope break. Rope break works that time. His famous special. No! No! No, eye poke. Woo! Ric Flair is one of the funniest wrestlers I've ever seen. His mannerisms, his promos, when he does his strut, and he takes off his jacket, gives the elbow drop, runs off, bounces off the ropes, does a strut. He's saying, keep your mouth shut, fat boy. Woo! And one time he freaked out when Goldberg threw him out of the ring, and Flair got mad, and he pointed at all the wrestlers in the ring. You're in trouble! You're in trouble! He looks at this kid at ringside. He goes, you shut up, kid! It's hilarious. Yep, Rick Steiner taps out. Oh boy, Ric Flair versus the Giant. The Giant's freaking ugly right there. I look like the Giant. Looks funny right there in the face. Here we go, Ric Flair versus the Giant. Oh, the Giant just strokes off Ric Flair. And I remember when Ric Flair got inducted to the Hall of Fame, Big Show was crying. And I think because, I mean, Ric Flair means a lot to the Big Show. Ric Flair means a lot to a lot of people. But the Giant won his first world title beating Ric Flair on an episode of Nitro in 96. Now, I know some people will say, no, he won his first world title by beating Hogan at Halloween Havoc 95. To me, that does not count because it was some stupid stipulation where he won it by, like he got disqualified. And there's a loophole in the contract that Jimmy Hart put in there saying if Hogan loses by disqualification or the Giant, Hogan got disqualified. It was all weird. It was a weird mess. That was when the Yeti came out and the Giant fell off the building after the Monster Truck match. It was a mess. But supposedly the Giant won by disqualification. I guess because Jimmy Hart, who was managing Hogan, hit the referee from behind, and another referee saw that and disqualified Hogan because of that. I don't know. It was weird. And so the Giant won the belt by disqualification. And like a week later, Nick Lambros, the WCW lawyer, whoever the heck it was, said, all right, look, because of the nature of how the Giant won it, he is going to be stripped of the belt, and it's going to be held up vacant at World War III, 95, in which the Macho Man won. Now, so I guess technically, in a way, the Giant was the champion for a week after Halloween Havoc, but it got stripped. To me, that doesn't count. At first, I thought it didn't count. But then it turns out, I guess it does, but to me, it doesn't. I don't care. To me, it doesn't count because that was so stupid. Just like David Arquette won the world title, that was stupid. And that never happened. And so, to me, the first real, genuine world title win came when the Giant beat Ric Flair on an episode of Nitro in April of 96. And so, Ric Flair, being the consummate professional he is and how he put people over, I mean, yeah, he's a 16-time world champion, but he's also put the right people over at the right time. And the Giant, he put him over at that time. Some say the Giant, it was too soon for the Giant to win the world title, but I mean, Flair at that time was past his prime. He was all about putting people over. Even though it was past his prime, he was still great in the ring and on the mic. And so he jobbed to the Giant, and I think that meant a lot to Paul White. And say what you want about the Big Show today. I know he may be boring and bland, but he's paid his dues in this business, and I liked him when he was a Giant, and I did like him at first as Big Show in 99. After that, I didn't care about him no more, but I do respect the man. When the Giant debuted in 1995 in WCW, man, that was a big deal, and I really thought he was Andre's son. Ric Flair going for the figure four leg lock. This is how the Giant beat him. He reached over, grabbed him by the throat as woman started screeching at ringside. Ric! Ah! And then chokeslammed him, and then the Giant won. Now the Giant is hurt, though. Flair going with the figure four again. Giant gives it up. Oh, yeah. The classic matchup of Ric Flair versus Sting. They closed out the last Nitro. They closed out WCW. These two have had a long-running feud since, like, what, 88? From 88 to, like, 2001. They pretty much had a feud off and on. Yes, this is my favorite track in the game. Sting also won his first world title by beating Ric Flair. Sting and Ric Flair, they closed out the last episode of Nitro, and it made perfect sense. Sting beat Flair by making him submit to the Scorpion Deathlock, and after that they embraced. That was a good thing to witness. That was good times. Flair will be inducting Sting in the Hall of Fame this year. That would be epic. I'll be at WrestleMania, but I would not be able to attend at the Hall of Fame. But I'll watch it on the network. Definitely got to see it. So, yeah, I mean, Ric Flair put Sting's career on the map. Sting was the one constant in WCW. He was there to the very, very end. Never left anywhere. I never left four anywhere. I remember Halloween Havoc 95. A good thing that happened to Halloween Havoc 95 was, I mean, at the time it pissed me off, but Flair suckered Sting in. And I mean, I'm sorry, but they always had Sting being portrayed as the most gullible wrestler in the business. I mean, he was just a sucker. And Flair suckered him in, making him think he was a good guy on his side. And then they turned on him. Him and the Horsemen turned on him at Halloween Havoc. And then, so the feud started with Sting again. They wrestled at World War III, which was funny because there were three rings. at World War III. Flair kept on running from Sting, going to ring number 2 and 3, begging for mercy. Oh, great stuff. Pretty much everything Flair did was gold. And I heard a story about how Ric Flair was wrestling Kerry Von Erich, who apparently fell asleep during the match. I heard this on PW Insider years ago. Kerry Von Erich fell asleep during a match, and Flair was wrestling him, had to have him in the headlock. And Flair still knew how to work. He knew how to work the match with Kerry Von Erich. So that proves that Ric Flair can have a match, a good match, with a broomstick. Flair with the figure four leglock. Sting has never submitted to the figure four. The only time I think he's ever submitted to anybody was, I think, against Magnus in TNA. And some people might say, well, that don't count. And, well, technically it does. And I hear you. I hear you. And you don't want to count it. Mick Foley tapped out to Kurt Angle in TNA. That's a shocker. That makes sense, though, because, I mean, that's freaking Kurt Angle. With all due respect to Magnus, I mean, not Magnus. Hey, guys, Magnus here. This wrestling match is just as good as their real-life ones. Too bad Sting won't wrestle this year in Dallas at WrestleMania. Man, that sucks. Injuries suck. That's where wrestling gets real, people. People really do get injured. All right. Oh, that's the famous press slam that he does with Flair all the time. Sting favoring that leg. Oh, man. Flair might be out. Yeah, it's been a while since I played this game. So getting used to the controls pretty good here. All right, backslide.
Two count.
Oh, 2 3/4. Oh, knocks Sting out of the ring.
One.
Ooh, he's styling, profiling right there. Flair is the man. The only two-time WWE Hall of Famer. For like the 20th time, Ric Flair put Sting in the figure four.
Rope.
No, rope break. This is a long time no play right here. I mean, it really has been probably 15 or so years since I played this game. Now he's going for the figure four again. This time he's in the middle of the ring. Sting has nowhere to go. Oh, for the first time ever, Sting taps out to Ric Flair's figure four. Oh, here we go. The WCW World Heavyweight Championship against DDP, Diamond Dallas Page. I loved Diamond Dallas Page. All right, he kind of did the pose right there. He didn't do the bang, but that's okay. Diamond Dallas Page was so over in like 97, 98. It was ridiculous. I did not like Diamond Dallas Page at all until he started having a feud with the NWO. I mean, DDP was just awesome. He became a better wrestler when he feuded with the NWO. I like how he put the diamond cutter on Scott Hall after making the NWO think he was a member. I mean, DDP was awesome. 96, 97. 97, that's the year he really came up. And the cool thing is, Diamond Dallas Page didn't start wrestling until he was 35, which is how old I am now. I mean, man, so he started late, but man, he still did great. DDP needs to go in the Hall of Fame one day. And he's been helping Jake Snake Roberts and Scott Hall get their lives back on track. He has DDP Yoga. He was on Shark Tank. Didn't get the funds to back up his business, but he still got him exposure. And from what I understand, DDP Yoga is successful. So yeah, Diamond Dallas Page is awesome. Really loved him back in WCW back in the day, up until like 99, where he won the world title, which is cool, but then after that he turned heel, he cut his hair, he looked different, and then that's when he just started to look and act different. I didn't care about him no more. But during that 97, 98, and early 99 period, man, he was awesome. Flair and DDP now going at it. The World Heavyweight Championship. And again, Diamond Dallas Page won his first world championship beating Ric Flair at Spring Stampede 99. That was when DDP won the title. And again, you know, Flair putting people over, having them win the world title. So Flair put a lot of people over. He made a career out of making other people look good beside himself. Ric Flair is the man. All right. Now, that match was a four corners match. It was Sting as a special referee. Macho Man was a special referee. Sting was in the match, his return after being gone since Halloween Havoc 98. So it was Sting, Flair, DDP, and Hogan in that match. Hogan got injured, I think, kayfabe during the match. So it's just Sting, Flair, DDP. DDP put the diamond cutter on Ric Flair. Bang! One, have a new world heavyweight champion. Two. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, that was a three. But anyway. DDP favoring that neck. Uh-oh, inside cradle. One, two. No. Instead of commentating like McMahon, the King, or JR, should start commentating like Schiavone. This is the single greatest match in the history of our great sport. Flair with a dropkick. I love Bobby Heenan was also in WCW. I love his commentary along with Schiavone's. It was cool. But Schiavone wasn't that bad. He's better than Michael Cole. Jeez. Giovanni wasn't the best, but I mean, he wasn't that bad either. He just needed to stop saying everything was, is like every night's the greatest night in the history of our great sport. No, it's not. He overused that phrase a lot. It was ridiculous. Oh, nice tombstone there. Tombstone, cradle, pile drive, whatever you want to call it. All right, going for the figure four now. Nope, DDP will not give up. Oh. Will he give up this time? No, he will not. Oh, repeat knees to the face. You hear that? What the heck? I remember like Slugger, he would get hit. You hear, oh! Oh! Oh, a page out of Arn Anderson's book. The freaking spine buster. Nice. Figure four in the middle of the ring. Will he tap? Not McMahon. Schiavone. Will he tap out of here? Yes, he will. He gives up. Ric Flair's the new World Heavyweight Champion. Wait a minute, that's not the world title belt. That's a trophy. What's this, Mario Kart? Come on, man. Where's the big gold belt? Now, if I understand, wrestlers in Japan compete for trophies and stuff, so this is a world tour. I don't know. Oh, newsflash. What's going on here? Look for Damda's page has been unlocked. All right, what else to do here? This time we're going to the NWO League. We got Hogan, the fake Sting, Buff Bagwell, Eric Bischoff over there, Scott Norton, who is awesome, Kevin Nash. All right, this time it's Hollywood Hogan against Scott Flash Norton. Now, Scott Flash Norton didn't play around. He made his debut in WCW on the first episode of Nitro. It's Hollywood Hogan, morons. All right. Fight. Scott Flash Norton started a small, it wasn't really a feud, just a one-time thing. Started a, like a one-time match with the Macho Man Randy Savage, which they had the next week. On the very second edition of Nitro. This music's not the best for a wrestling match, but okay. Uh-oh, British Bulldog suplex here. Nicely done. Going for the high knee, not from the booty man. Oh, wow. Boss man uppercut right there. I wonder if Scott Norton's still wrestling right now. I'm not sure, but, man, he was freaking awesome. There's the weak version of the Hogan leg drop. That NWO sold out pay-per-view in 97 was complete garbage. Terrible. But sold out 98 was actually pretty freaking good. That was when Dusty Rhodes turned heel and joined the NWO. That was a shocker. That was almost as big of a shocker as Hogan turning heel.
2, 3.
That heel turn did not last long as he would turn face, I think, later on that year. Cody Rhodes said that when he was a kid and he saw that, he thought his dad really had turned his back on everybody. Started, like, throwing a fit, being real mad, and Dusty Rhodes' wife called him saying, look, you need to talk to Cody. He's real upset. And then Dusty explained to him, it's okay, son. I didn't really join the dark side. You know, it's all scripted. It's okay. And I know, you know, that's a horrible thing to do, break kayfabe to a little kid. Yeah, but if it gets that emotional for a little kid, you need to sit him down and say, look, it's fake. Or not say it like that, but, you know, explain to him how the business works. Now, I don't know if this is true or not, but when Hogan turned heel, I think Schiavone said, we had parents call the offices of WCW complaining that their children were crying up all night because Hogan had turned their backs on him. And I'm like, well, the parents need to explain to him that he's not really a bad guy, he's all act. So come on. Of course, that might have been WCW playing kayfabe right there.
One.
Oh, this could be it right in the middle of the ring.
Two count.
Not going to be Scott Flash Thornton that easily. Oh, Hogan with a drop kick. Nice power slam. Oh, he misses the big leg. Clubbing forearm. You're not going to be Hogan that quick. Even though I'm sure Scott Norton would beat Hogan for real. All right, Hogan's got Scott Orton. Dang it, not Randy Orton. Scott Norton. Scott Norton slowly getting back to his feet. It's not Scott Orton or Randy Norton. It's Scott Norton. It'd be funny. His move is called the finish move is called the Norton Antivirus. Fail. Unless he had a gimmick where he was a nerd. Of course, I don't think Norton Antivirus is around 97. Then again, maybe it was. I don't know. But anyway. Irish whip. Hogan, oh man, massive clothesline.
1, 2, 2 count.
Oh, Scott Norton will not give up. NWO, should be called the Norton World Order, when they split in two. The Black and White had a feud where to see who was the leader of the Black and White. The B team at the time. And Stevie Ray won, which is, that's a joke. Scott Norton would pwn all of them. Oh, he is out. Wow, he is out by TKO. Uh-oh. Hollywood Hogan. Get it right, guys. Hollywood Hogan versus Scott Hall. Hey, yo. It looks funny. It looks like Scott Hall. Jeez. All right, Scott Hall. Hogan, the founding father is going at it here. Hogan and Hall. Oh, test of strength here. Come on, Hogan's going to win that one. Oh, well, maybe not.
Two. two.
Oh, wow. Imagine Hogan doing that in real life. Oh, superplex. What? Dang. Hogan ain't messing around. Another great announcer in WCW was Mike Tenay. He was pretty cool. Hogan posing now. He's got the upper hand on Scott Hall. Yeah, this is before they started having like real entrances. That didn't happen until like I think WrestleMania 2000. Well, now they had entrances on Revenge, but not with the actual entrance music. Uh-oh, Hogan, he's hulking up, even though he's not doing his trademark hulking. Uh-oh, choking the life out of Scott Hall now. Scott Hall slowly getting to his feet. Again, choking him. Come on, ref, get in there. Oh, man, that's your running buddy, man. That's one of the guys that started the New World Order with you. A leg drop on the leg. Oh, nice clothesline. That body drop. Was that Shawn Michaels' old finisher move? What is Hogan begging for mercy for? You're beating Scott Hall. Uh-oh. Throw it across the top rope. Hogan going to the top now, which is something he's rarely done. Oh, super leg drop. Wow, nice. He's gone to the top at WrestleMania 7, but I don't think he succeeded. Man, Scott Hall still kicked out of that? No way. What's that noise when you do an illegal move? Jeez. Uh-oh, he's hulking up. Oh, the leg drop.
One.
This is lame, though. Should bounce off the ropes. Man, Scott Hall would not give up. Hogan's frustrated. Let's choke him again. Why won't you die?
Give up.
Wait a minute. What? That's an illegal choke, ref. How'd he tap out of that? How was he allowed to choke? I guess the task could choke you out. I guess Hogan can too. Nice. I loved Buff Bagwell. That's funny right there. Really? Jeez. I did not like the Handsome Stranger or Marcus Alexander Bagwell. I liked Buff Bagwell when he joined the NWO. After he left, I didn't care about him anymore. I only liked Buff when he was with the NWO because he was freaking funny. My friend's dad would always say, I like Buff. He looks like a Chippendale reject right here. Where's Judy Bagwell at? Jeez. The former, one half of the former WCW World Tag Team Champions. Jeez, her and Rick Steiner were like tag team champions together. That was so stupid. Judy Bagwell in a pole match. Thanks, Vince Russo. Hogan going to the top again. Oh, got him with a big leg drop. Hogan, instead of pinning him, wants to torture him some more. Oh, Buff Bagwell might be out. No, he's not. Man, that looks stiff. What are you doing begging? Get up. That's what you get. You get pimp slap. This music right here is starting to sound like Mega Man X music a little bit. Boomer Quanger's music or something. It's a pretty cool track though right here. Uh-oh. He might make Buff tap out right here. Nope. Could this be it right here? Yep, that's it. Buff ain't the stuff right here. Got the stuffing beat out of him. Hollywood Hogan versus Eric Bischoff. What is this, WCW 2000, where Hogan wanted to get his hands on him? Give me a break. Bischoff, you're going to get pwned. Don't even look like Bischoff in the face. Looks like some idiot. Oh, Bischoff getting pwned already. What are you doing, Hogan? I hired you, man. I paid you big money. Come on. Come on, Bischoff. Use your karate moves. Going for the pin early. No, Bischoff kicks out at zero. Come on, Bischoff. Use karate moves now. There you go. Wow, nice. And he made Hogan mad. I like Zbyszko as a commentator, too. He was funny.
Well, Tony, you got to be aggressive. I mean, 20 glorious years in this sport. I mean, you know, you got to be aggressive in there. Watch out for this guy. I mean, you got to go for the Holy Grail, the World Heavyweight Championship of the World.
Ah, that was... What? Oh, press slam. Nice. Oh, I was going to give Bischoff some special treatment.
One.
Weak finish move that is. A weak pin. And Bischoff still kicks out, barely. Hogan's ticked off because how lame that move was. Oh, he might make Bischoff tap out right here. So I guess it's not a choke. Maybe he's just pulling his ears. I don't know what the heck. Bischoff will not give up. Electro to the leg.
One, two, three. Three count.
He got him. I remember Scott Steiner hit someone with a crowbar in the leg, and Shivani goes, "Did you see that man's leg? Oh, no." Oh, Hollywood versus the other founding father of the New World Order, Kevin Nash. That's Jesus. What? So Hollywood Hogan's fighting Jesus. This is one guy you better job to, Hogan. You got to pull off a miracle to beat him. All right, here we go. Oh, high knee. Yes, play my favorite track again. Oh, drop kick by Hogan. Throws Nash across the top rope. Throw first. Oh, missed the big leg drop. I don't think Nash would. And Nash did drop to Hogan in Hog Wild 99. He also dropped to Hogan before that with the finger poke of doom on the famous January 4th, 99 episode of Nitro. Same night that Mick Foley won the world title on Raw. That would have put people's butts in the seats. Blech. Oh, nice. Hogan the drop kick. Nash goes to the ring apron. Oh, man. Knocks into the guardrail. Ouch.
One.
Hogan posing now.
Two. Three.
Come on now. Nash steps over the top rope, not between the ropes. Oh, man. Hogan knocks him back out. Man, he's, man, Hogan ain't playing around. Oh, knocks Nash out of the ring again.
One.
Hogan going to the top now. Oh, the big leg drop. Did it connect?
One. Two. Two count.
No, it didn't, because Nash kicked out. Got him the high knee. Boston Crab by Hollywood Hogan. Rick Martel called. He wants his finishing move back. Nash will not give up. Oh, got him the drop kick. Leg drop off the leg.
One, two, two count.
Oh, Nash will not give up. Oh, I wonder if he'll give up from that.
One, two, three. Three count fall.
Now time for the NWO Single Championship. Oh, yeah. Hollywood Hogan versus Macho Man Randy Savage. They collide again. The Mega Powers collide again, brother. Don't look like Macho Man. Look like Al Borland from Home Improvement. And here they go for like the 10th time. Mega Powers colliding. It was so awesome to see Macho Man get inducted last year in the Hall of Fame. Hogan going for the leg. Oh, nice drop kick. All right, here we go again with the British Bulldog suplex. British Bulldog, who in my opinion should be in the Hall of Fame as well. Oh, Macho Man now in the corner. I remember the classic match at WrestleMania 5. From Hogan beat Macho Man for the world title. That was around the time when Macho Man turned heel, became the Macho King. Oh yeah. Nice press slam. Hollywood Hogan in control. Man, I wish he'd just run off the ropes to the leg drop. Looks so lame.
Two count.
I think you do that, I forgot.
One, two.
Nope, Savage is a fighter. Just like he always was in real life. Oh! Drop kick between the ropes. Hollywood Hogan suplexes him back to the ring. Another Hogan leg drop. Looks like Savage's arm is underneath the rope, but oh well. Yes, I win. All right, I want to use one of the custom characters here from THQ, Black Ninja, against Paco Loco in the Independent Union. Black Ninja, all right. How original. All right, here we go. I love using Black Ninja. He's pretty cool. And to one of the other custom-made organizations here in the Independent Union. So yeah, Black Ninja's definitely got some cool moves, but he's wearing a red belt, so he's not really a black belt. So is he a true ninja? Oh wait a minute, is he wearing a black belt? I can't understand. Whatever. Anyway, so you play a shinobi here against Paco from Bloodsport, or Paco Loco, whatever his name is. Ninja wrestler. He reminds me of two ninja wrestlers back in, I think it was USWA. I think where the Von Erichs had a few of them, and they were managed by Tojo Yamamoto. And they also managed P.Y. Chuhai. And that's some old wrestling reference right there for the five people watching this who actually understand the old school wrestling reference. Props if you know who I'm talking about. There's a taunt. Come on, Joe Musashi. That's what you get for celebrating too early. Come on now. You're a ninja. Show discipline. I think there was a wrestler named the Giant Ninja or something. Who was played by Ron Reese, who was the big the Yeti. He looked like Scorpion. Jeez. Look at the perfect place right there. Oh, knocks him off the ring apron into the guardrail as he slowly gets up. No mats out there, just a wooden floor.
Three.
Nice move. This character's much better than Avatar. The character, not the movie.
Two.
Oh, come on, ref, that was three. Avatar was played by Al Snow. It's a stupid ninja gimmick. I think he also played, actually, I think Al Snow also played as Shinobi. A wrestling character named Shinobi, that's cool. All right, oh, could this be it?
One, two, three.
Yes, it is, that is it. All right, so that's all I'm going to show of WCW NWO World Tour. Pretty fun THQ game for its time. I loved it back in the day. Great wrestling game. This game has lasted the test of time to a certain degree because it's still pretty much fun to play today. And I remember my friend in high school telling me, yeah, but man, Nitro and Thunder is kind of fun on its own in PS1, but man, this game right here has actual good gameplay, and I gave it a chance, and it freaking worked. Funny story regarding this game, I actually has something to do with Raw, at WWF Warzone for N64. Me and my friend from high school, we were talking trash for each other on, I can whoop you in the game, no, I can whoop you. Well, it turns out I actually beat him. So I was beating him, and he tried to do a trick where he got himself counted out so he can keep his belt. And he started laughing at me. And then we go to the main option screen or the screen, whatever, after that. Turns out he still lost his title. So we tried to be slick, but it backfired on him, and I still won his belt. And he goes, oh, yeah, well, you can't beat me in WCW NWO World Tour. And I said, bring it. So we faced each other in that, and that's where he beat me. He really pwned me in this game. I was not good at this game, and he took me to school. But it was still fun times. Very fun to play wrestling games with your friends back then. It was all good. So give this game a chance if you haven't tried it out. Very fun wrestling game. All right, guys, that is it. I am out of here. I do have a few more games on the road to WrestleMania, so stay tuned. I'm Ron Moore. God bless, and take care.